First, thanks to Jaipreet for inviting me, and others were involved as well, I'm sure. I hope someday to actually meet you all as three-dimensional people in person. Let me just say up front, also thank you to the panelists for most of you keeping your cameras on. I don't need everybody. It's just nice to have a few faces for my eyes to rest on. Otherwise, like talking to a wall, I've discovered with my glasses. Just a few of you will do. Thank you very much. Also, let me say that I welcome interruptions. It's a little weird, I know, for a formal talk, but I really look forward to being told things like, I didn't get that. Could you explain that? Make sense of that? That sort of thing. Larger scale objections, questions, and so forth maybe should wait to the end. But I'm happy to interrupt, generally speaking. Let me start by sharing content here. So let me start with a remark from Mark Twain, one of his lesser known remarks. He said, children make the best teachers. They tell you everything they know and then they stop. Well, I'm going to spend the first 90% or so of this talk abiding by Twain's admonition and just tell you stuff that I know or I'm fairly confident of. But then being an adult, I really don't know when to stop. So I'm just going to keep going in the last 10% and start talking about things I have no business talking about. Wild speculation that will strike you as bizarre. At any rate, let's start with the stuff I know or sort of know. My topic today is goal-directedness, teleology, purpose. I'm using these as synonyms. I know they're not, but that's how I'm using them here. There's a sort of timeless mystery that goes with these, with this single concept, these three words. And the question, the mystery is, how does it work? It looks on the surface of, if you look at particular cases of goal-directedness, it looks like future causation. You look at the acorn, you stick it in the ground, you water it, and it blooms into an oak tree. Where did that come from? It really looks like, and it has for thousands of years, going back to Aristotle, who used this as an example, it really looks like the future oak tree is somehow reaching back from the future and drawing the acorn toward itself, right? Which future causation, we don't accept that. It's metaphysically suspect today. It looks impossible from a modern perspective, though Aristotle had no trouble with it. Centuries, a millennium plus later, Kant went on to say, in response to the modern way of thinking, there will never be a Newton for a blade of grass. That's the famous Kant quote. And what he meant by that was Newton solved mechanics. He solved the problem of motion. He explained motion in a mechanistic level. And Kant was bold enough to say that nobody will come along and do that for the goal-directedness of a blade of grass, for the purposefulness of it, for the manifestation of a full blade of grass from a seed. There is no mechanistic Newton-style explanation for it. Some people think that in the 19th century, Darwin came along and slapped Kant down by finding a mechanism for it. After all, the blade of grass is the product of natural selection, and natural selection more or less accounts for the goal-directedness of the blade of grass, as well as for the acorn turning into the oak tree. But the problem with that is it's only half a solution. Darwin solved the problem of origins. He solved the problem of where we get mechanisms that will do that sort of thing. He didn't solve the problem of proximate causation. He didn't solve the problem of how the blade of grass does it. How does the acorn do it? What's going on inside that enables it to produce this kind of, yes, it was produced by natural selection, but what is the actual mechanism inside? And Darwin didn't solve that half of the problem. So that's the timeless mystery. There's a related timeless mystery, which has to do with the relationship between all these different goal-directed systems, and I'm about to give you five big categories of them, and human goal-directedness, human wanting, intentionality, preferring, caring. Again, I'm using all of these words interchangeably. Human goal-directedness seems to be qualitatively different. It seems like a different sort of phenomenon than the ones in the natural world. So acorns don't want to become oak trees. They don't intend to become oak trees. There's nothing like that, we don't think, going on within acorns. So what is the connection between these two? And the theory I'm going to present you with today tries to make that connection explicit. So five big categories of goal-directed systems that I've come up with. If you can think of others, let me know. There are the physiological behavioral ones. For example, a bacterium following a food gradient, moving up the food gradient towards higher concentrations of its food. And I'm going to come back to that example in a bit. That's a behavioral example. There are also plenty of physiological ones. I'll mention some of them. Then there's developmental goal-directed systems. That's the acorn turning into an oak. And then there's technological ones like the homing torpedo that I'm going to be talking about later, and GPS direction finding and map systems that we all have in our phones and in our cars. Another big category, there's lots of other technological goal-directed systems these days. And then a fourth category is evolutionary adaptation. The process of natural selection itself looks in some lights. The climbing of fitness peaks looks a little bit like a torpedo seeking a target if you look at it in certain lights. But it looks goal-directed in some ways too. And then finally, human intentionality. The theory I'm going to give you connects all of these, purporting to offer a common architecture that joins them all. The ones we do understand, which is number one, physiology, behavior. Number three, the technology, we understand it because we built it, and then evolutionary adaptation, which we've got a pretty good handle on. The theory I'm going to present offers to connect those three with the two that we really don't understand very well, development and human intentionality. So let me start with the question of how this goal-directedness works, but more broadly, is it internal or external? And I raise it this way because most of the history of the discussion of goal-directedness, purpose, teleology, and so forth, has assumed that it's internal. The acorn does it all by itself, it looks like. And that was the ancient explanation. Aristotle had a notion that there were internal natures to objects. It's the internal nature of a heavy object to move toward the earth. It does it because of something within it. And it's the internal nature of an acorn to turn into an oak tree. There's something going on within it. In the 18th and 19th century, the internalist explanation was vitalism. There's some vital force or vital substance that's within all living organisms that directs them, that give them this goal-directedness that most other systems seem not to have. And then, of course, the modern story, not subscribed to by everyone, but certainly by a lot of people, including most of the textbooks, is also internalist. That, yeah, we don't believe in vital forces. We don't believe in internal natures. These are metaphysically suspect today. We don't talk that way. We have no evidence for them. But there's genes. And genes are understood to be capable of producing the goal-directedness we see in development and physiology and in organisms generally. The modern answer, by the way, to the question of teleology is internalist for technology and for wanting as well. For technology, in a homing torpedo, it's assumed that we talk as though the directing mechanism is the mechanism of the torpedo and that accounts for its goal directedness. And for wanting, intentionality, human purposes, and so on, we assume that it's got something to do with cognition, with the thoughts going through my head, and that's internal too, right? So modern thinking is thoroughly internalist. I'm going to argue this is all wrong, that the problem here for goal-directedness is the source of direction, where it comes from, and that it cannot be internal. Well, I should say almost cannot be internal. And let me walk you through a couple of examples. Sunflowers are known to track the movement of the sun across the sky during the day, and they do it with some elaborate mechanism with a genetic basis and various hormones secreted by the plant that cause it to lengthen on one side versus the other and twist the head toward the sun. All that is reasonably well understood. Here's the problem with it being internal, though. None of that internal machinery knows where the sun is. It's just not in there. If it wants to follow the sun, it needs external information, the source of guidance almost has to be external, because that's where the information is. Sunflower on its own, without that source of external direction, won't do a darn thing, which is not to downplay or minimize the importance of those internal mechanisms. They're absolutely critical. They don't do the directing. They don't tell it which way to go, which way to turn. Take the homing torpedo. Fancy mechanism inside. I don't understand how these things work. I'm sure there's a lot of interesting electronics going on inside of a homing torpedo and its various analogs in military warfare today. But whatever that machinery is, it doesn't know where the target is. The information isn't in there. You wouldn't need to have a homing torpedo if it did. That information has to come from outside. The source of direction has to be from outside. And then in development, embryonic transformation, acorn into oak, embryo into adult, and so forth. Could it be the genes? Really, no, because the genes don't have access to the proper information. They're sitting there buried inside of individual cells, doing their switching on and off, producing of this and that messenger RNA and this and that protein and so forth. The genes within a given cell have no idea about your left arm and your right arm. How do they end up the same length? Somebody has to know that, right? Surely it's not the genes within individual cells. The genes in your right arm as it's developing don't know anything about the left arm. In order to get that information to them, there have to be larger scale structures external to them to convey that information. The genes are just not up to the job of directing development. And then for intentional thought, purposeful thought and behavior. So cognition is understood, generally speaking. The person on the street, including mine, when I'm not thinking carefully about it, is that cognition runs the goal-directed show in people. I perceive, I calculate, I reason, I think about something, and that's what enables me to be a goal-directed. The problem with that is that all those faculties I just mentioned, and I'll say more about this in a little bit, while internal, are not up to the job. They're all value neutral. Calculating, thinking, and so on, by itself, just perceiving of something, has no intentional aspect to it whatsoever, right? Something from outside needs to tell it, go this way with that thought, go that way with the thought, and same for behavior. I'll come back to this at the end. So my argument that it almost has to be external, let me back up and explain and say a little bit about the history of this, a very little bit about the history of this in the 20th century. There were maybe a dozen or so, mainly philosophers, who were interested in goal-directedness as opposed to function, which is a separate issue. We were interested in goal-directedness. One of the most prominent was Ernest Nagel, who attempted to come up with necessary and sufficient conditions for goal-directedness. And he identified what he called persistence and plasticity and another feature which has to do with independent mechanisms. We won't go into it, but persistence and plasticity were the heart of his defining criteria for goal-directed systems. Persistence is when a goal-directed entity deviates from a path toward a goal, it corrects. Deviation and correction, that's goal-directedness. Plasticity is connected with persistence. It says that no matter where you start or across a wide range of alternative starting conditions, you'll get to the same goal. So for the homing torpedo, obviously it's persistent. Something comes along and moves the torpedo a little bit off course, a change in the ocean currents, and it manages to correct itself. It persists. Further, the torpedo can be launched from a variety of different locations, and assuming it's homing in on the sound field coming off the ship, it'll still arrive at the target ship, all other things being equal. So persistence and plasticity, deviation and return, error and correction. The keeping tryingness of goal-directed systems is their hallmark. Now, Nagel was defining goal-directedness with these criteria and a couple others. I'm not engaging with the philosophical project here. I'm not looking for necessary and sufficient conditions. It's a worthy project. I don't think it went anywhere in the 20th century. No consensus was reached on any set of necessary and sufficient conditions for it. It's not what I'm up to. Instead, what I'm doing is taking an engineering approach to the problem. Let's look at all these directed systems, see how they work. Are there any commonalities among all of them, right? And maybe down the road we'll get to necessary and sufficient conditions, but I don't think we're ready for that. We don't understand them well enough yet. This is the approach that the philosopher of biology, Bill Wimsatt, has taken to a lot of problems. It's the reverse engineering approach. Okay, so here's my externalist theory. I'm going to give you the short version of it. I'm aiming for this to be a short talk. I don't know if it's going to work out that way. I'm just going to give you a sketch of the theory. My hope is that we can explore it further in a question and answer session, which is in some ways more organic. I call the theory field theory, and it's derivative of a mainly mid-20th century brand of theory called hierarchy theory. I give credit to Stanley Salty, Bill Wimsatt, Herbert Simon, and Donald Campbell, who were the central figures, I think, in hierarchy theory at that time. And the argument will be that there are four architectural features of all goal-directed systems. The first is hierarchy, nestedness, things within things, things physically within things. So conventionally, you can think of the military as a hierarchy, right? The chain of command is hierarchical, but there's no physical nestedness, right? Privates are not physically nested inside of sergeants, and sergeants not physically nested inside of captains, right? There's no physical containment. When I use the word hierarchy, I'm talking about physical containment. There are lower level entities, and those are the goal-directed ones, and they are immersed within physically upper level fields. Okay, and I'll say more about fields in just a moment. In fact, I'm about to say it right now. The second architectural feature is upper direction by the field. So the goal-directed entity, the little thing inside, is directed by the upper level field that it is immersed in. And I have a fairly permissive understanding of the word field. It's a kind of boundary condition. It's a large external structure of some kind with this capability of directing the things within it. More coming. Third requirement, third architectural feature, partial lower level freedom. The contained entity, the goal-directed entity, has to be somewhat free to do what it wants, to have its own properties independent of the external field. So the external field you should think of as nudging, pushing, giving some oomph to the directionality of the lower level thing without absolutely determining it. It's not standard causality we're talking about here in the domino falling sense, where if you've got a line of dominoes on it lined up on a table upright, you touch one and it goes down, the next one goes down, the next one goes down, and so on. A causes B causes C causes D. This is a different kind of structural relationship with a different kind of causality. And then fourth, the stability of the upper level field. The upper level field must be stable relative to the goal-directed entity contained within it. It doesn't have to be perfectly stable. It just has to change slowly relative to the thing that it's directing. The fifth that I have in parentheses on this slide, vagueness is not an architectural feature, but it is an interesting property, and I'll get to it when I talk about human goal-directedness. So let me walk through these terms a little bit more slowly using a concrete example, this one showing an electric plate, that's that vertical line over on the right with the minus signs next to it, and a particle, let's see if my pen works. Yeah, my pen works, and a particle within the electric field. So these dashed lines are the electric field generated by the plate. The particle has an opposite charge, and it's moving within the field. That's a hierarchical relationship. We have an entity that's nested within a field. Now, I'm just explaining terms here. I'm not going to claim in the end that this is a goal-directed system. In fact, I'm using it because it's sort of not a goal-directed system. At least we're not inclined to call it goal-directed. In the end, I think actually the boundary between boring systems like this and more interesting goal-directed ones is kind of fuzzy. But right now, I'm just using it to underscore these notions of hierarchy. And then the second, persistence and plasticity, you can see that this particle is not exactly following the field, it's deviating. It's, say it's got a propeller on it, I don't know. it's got some property of its own, independent of the field, that causes it to wobble. Right? Here it goes this way, here it goes this way, here it goes this way, and so on. but it comes back. It comes back to a general direction, a general movement toward the charged plate. And of course, it's also true that if you were to place this particle somewhere else in the field, it would also make a rough trajectory toward the plate. That's plasticity. Alternative starting points gives you the same, gives you progress toward the same target. This is upper direction, the higher level thing, the field, the big thing that encompasses the goal-directed entity is doing the directing. That's where the information about where to go comes from in this system. So let me pick another clearly non-goal-directed system. This one, it's a helium-filled balloon. It's supposed to be a helium-filled balloon hanging there neutrally in a room, suspended in space, neutrally buoyant. And the little arrow drawn within is the trajectory of a single helium atom within the balloon, zigzagging around as it bumps into the plastic of the balloon, bumps into other helium atoms, and so on. It charts this weird trajectory around the balloon, bounded on all sides by the plastic. If it ever encounters the plastic, it gets deflected back into the balloon. Now, suppose we move the balloon in space. You walk up to it, it's hanging neutrally in the room, you grab it and you move it around to some other location in the room. And that's the figure supposed to show its trajectory as you move it. Okay, let's look in the next slide at the trajectory of the particle, of the helium atom. And I don't know what they really look like, but here's a possible trajectory. It's going all kinds of different ways, right? Up, down, sideways, backwards sometimes, but it's following on average, as it has to, the trajectory of the balloon. This is upper directedness. There's no field in the conventional sense of the word. There's no magnetic field, electric field, gravitational field, or anything like that. It counts as a field in my permissive view because it's a larger containing system that directs the entity within it, right? And in this case, it does it via a boundary condition. In effect, the plastic of the balloon is saying to the helium atom, do whatever you want. I don't care. I'm not going to control what you do, except do not cross that plastic, right? And it's got good physical oomph behind that demand, right? And that counts as a field. So I've got a fairly broad notion of the field. Let me pick you. Give you one that's at the opposite end of some spectrum I'm not sure I could identify. Here's a higher level entity, a herd of bison. Are they buffalo? I call them buffalo in this slide. I'm not sure I'd know a buffalo from a bison. If anybody knows, please sing out. I'm going to call them bison. So there's the herd grazing away. Pick an animal. I picked an animal. And let's look at its trajectory. Well, it's munching on some grass here, and oh, there's a better patch over there, and there's a better patch over there, and oh, where did my calf go? I better turn left here and look for my calf. It's not there. I'll turn right. The wind's blowing from the west. I feel sort of like the wind in my face, so I could smell something coming. It's turning this way and that according to its own will. But it's got two wills here, and the other will is to stay with the herd. So if you were to chart the trajectory of an individual bison over time, you would discover a zigzag trajectory looking a lot like the helium atom in the balloon, where here the larger containing structure has no boundary, has no wall. It's diffuse, it's porous, it's the herd as a whole, right? Fancy internal mechanisms inside the head of the buffalo getting it, causing it to want to be roughly following the herd, and that's what accounts for it. That's all there was, just a desire to be with the herd. With no information about where the herd is, it wouldn't be able to do it. All the direction about where to turn on average for this bison comes from the herd itself, comes from the upper level. Okay, so that was, let me make sure there's nothing else I wanted to say about that. Right. Okay, so all of that is conceptual preparation. I'm now going to run through examples of the various kinds of goal-directed systems, the four kinds, and then a set-aside for human intentionality. I'm going to talk about the four architectural features: hierarchy, upper direction, lower level freedom, upper level stability. I'm not going to offer you a proof of any kind. My goal here is to show you what I mean, have you appreciate what I mean, if not believe it. And my claim is a fairly strong one, is that all goal-directed systems have this architecture, but that's not analytic. That's just because I can't think of any that don't. I can imagine, and we'll get to this if there's time or come up in question and answer, I can imagine that you could design a system that didn't have this hierarchical upper-level directedness structure to it. It would be bad engineering, is my argument. Yes, it could be done, but it would be terrible engineering. There's a reason why systems aren't designed that way. You need that external direction to make it work well. But I'll leave it to you to produce counterexamples. So let's start with behavior. In this very silly cartoon, what you're supposed to be looking at is a pond in which somebody has thrown a peanut butter sandwich, or it fell out of a boat or something like that. I don't know. But there's the peanut butter sandwich sitting in the water. And diffusing out of the peanut butter is the amino acid aspartate. I believe, in fact, peanut butter has aspartate in it. So if you threw it into a pond, it would diffuse out. And the dashed lines that you see here are the gradient, the aspartate gradient coming off of the peanut butter sandwich into the water. They're getting wider with time because the diffusion is taking the aspartate further and further apart. So there's a sort of cone of decreasing intensity, of decreasing concentration of the aspartate. And here is a bacterium with a flagellum that's following the gradient, that wants, in heavy quotes, because of course it doesn't want anything, that behaves persistently and plastically in pursuit of higher concentration. It's actually kind of interesting how these things do it. It's not very intuitive, at least not to me. They have two modes of action. One is what's called the straight run. The bacterium will use its flagellum to go in a straight line, and then it'll stop and switch to random tumble. So it's straight line, random tumble, straight line, random tumble. And the only thing, the only parameter that the mechanism, the internal mechanism internal to the bacterium imposes on it, is that when the concentration is higher, straight runs are longer. And if there are any physics-y minded people in the audience, that will be clear to you why that is. To me, it seems like the long straight runs in areas of high concentration could just as easily take you away from the target. But I'm assured by people that know that it works. I'm also assured by watching this under a microscope, you can actually see it. they do move up gradient. Okay, so what to say about this? We've got the setup, we've got a bacterium with a flagellum going up gradient. Its behavior is persistent and plastic amidst all these tumbles and straight runs, most of which produce errors. To some degree, they're not straight up the gradient. It nevertheless comes back to an on average trajectory toward higher concentration. That's persistence, right? Deviation and return, error and correction, trying again and again. Also for plasticity, that's clearly there. The bacterium can start anywhere in the food gradient and do play the same game and presumably get to the peanut butter sandwich that way. So there's hierarchy. It's nested within the upper level field. We've got upper direction. You might want to stop and question that. Wait, isn't the direction coming from the rough and tumble mechanism buried within the bacterium? Yes, I say that's important, that mechanism. It's critical, that mechanism. Without it, nothing happens, right? But it doesn't do the directing. It doesn't aim the thing. It doesn't say, no, there's more aspartate this way and less that way. No, that message never gets sent without the external field. The source of directionality is always external. Yes, okay, the third architectural feature was lower level freedom. Boy, in this case, is there plenty of lower level freedom. That bacterium's moving all over the place. Fourth architectural feature, the stability of the upper level field. In order for this system to be goal-directed, to act in a goal-directed way, it absolutely requires that that upper level gradient be relatively stable, right? If it's varying, if the water currents are such that the gradient is a mess or being made a mess of moment to moment, you won't see goal-directed behavior by the bacterium. The gradient can change. It can change gradually, provided it does so slowly on a time scale relative to the movements of the bacterium. Then goal-directedness will work fine. Let's look at alternative ways to understand this. I've presented a hierarchical understanding of it, where the upper level field is doing the directional, is conveying the directional information. There's two other ways you might think to talk about this and to think about this. You might think of the sandwich as the source of direction, right? That's the goal, after all. It's providing the aspartate. Isn't it doing the directing? And the answer is no. The answer is no, because the sandwich for the bacterium isn't there. It's not present. All it sees is aspartate around it. The sandwich is in the future. In fact, there need not be any sandwich. All you need is the gradient, then it'll go up gradient, right? Right. So there is the goal, the so-called goal that we talk about in goal-directedness, which is a terrible name for this concept, need not be present. There need not be a goal. All that's necessary is the field that the goal, generally speaking, generates. All right. So no, the sandwich is not the source of direction. The field created by the sandwich is the source of direction. And then another possible idea you might have, actually I've addressed this already, internal mechanisms of the bacteria is the source of direction. No, they just don't have that capability because the information isn't there. So here is where I've laid out how I want to describe this. A bacterium with some appropriate internal mechanism, not to be downplayed, it's important, moves within a higher level system, in this case the food gradient, which contains it and directs it from above. Right? That's the language I want to use to describe this and all, really, goal-directed systems. Technology. The homing torpedo is sort of obvious. The upper level system is the sound field coming off the target ship, not the target ship itself. And the sound field is doing the directing. But let me take, since that one is so obvious, let me take a different example, the GPS in your phone. So there you are in your car with you and your phone and the car and a steering wheel and gas, which down here in North Carolina, we don't have at the moment because of that Soviet hack of the pipeline. But back when we had gas, this was how it worked. You turn on your phone and the phone tells you, you know, go left at the next light, go 1,000 yards and then turn right, that sort of thing. How does this work? Well, the fancy technology inside the phone, the even fancier technology inside your head, right? The amazing capabilities of your car, if you stop and think about it too long, it'll fry your brain, that all these technologies work together to produce goal-directedness, except they don't. None of this works. None of the direction, none of the information about where to go is present in the phone, in you, or in the car. It's in the network of the cell towers and the satellite that feeds them. That's where the direction comes from. This is one of those cases where you could imagine, just barely imagine, a system that didn't depend on upper direction. Let me lay it out for you. You'd have a car and you punch into it. I'm at home and I want to go to New York. And the car would have built into its electronics, or your phone would have built into it, all the left and right turns and how long the car had to be moving before making them, how long it had to be moving at what speed. So as it pulls out of the driveway, go at 16 miles an hour, stop because there's a stop sign there, turn right, go about a quarter of a mile, there's another stop sign, turn left, and so on until we got to New York. And the car could have built into it, into that software, that hardware, all possible routes to New York. It's possible, right? Problem is, it would be extraordinarily error sensitive. The slightest mistake in the calculation of distance or speed or how much to turn the steering wheel and so forth would put me in the ditch, in the woods, right? It would be a stupid way to design a goal-directed car. How much easier to have a higher scale field where all the information, which is constantly locating you in space, you're here, says the field. You're there, said the field. Now you're over here, says the field. And maybe it doesn't provide directions. Maybe that's all built into the phone and the car. That's possible. But the information of where you are in space has to come from outside. That's the source of direction. Okay. Development. I'm going to give you a couple examples of development. They serve slightly different purposes. This is development in a sea urchin embryo, and what you're looking at is an early embryo that's here in A. It's got a north pole. Developmental biology identifies a north pole and a south pole in this embryo. And there's this population of cells that arises at the south pole and migrates up to the equator. And these cells are going to become the skeleton, the larval skeleton of the sea urchin embryo, the pluteus, when it enters the larval stage. But they have to get to the equator first. Some cool experiments have been done where these cells have been plucked out with a micropipette and injected into the north pole of the embryo. And guess what? They migrate back down to the equator. The thinking is that the whole embryo has this field, this morphogenetic field spanning the entire thing. It's almost certainly a biochemical gradient that provides positional information to every cell, wherever it is, plasticity, whatever your starting point. Make a deviation, go a little bit off course, not headed for the equator, fine. The gradient tells you, the morphogenetic gradient tells you which way to go to get back, right? It's something bigger than the cells, something external to the cells. Yes, genetic machinery is required in order to make this work, but it's not the source of directionality. Another example, a more complicated one, this one having to do with the development of a fruit fly, which you see the embryo of here. This is the head. For those of you not familiar, maybe it's obvious. This is the tail of the embryo. And what you see here is the pattern of segments, the segmentation of the embryo, which arises quite early. These segments are later going to differentiate to produce bits of the head, abdomen, thorax, and so on. But right now, they're just differentiated into this series running the length of the embryo from top, from left to right, from head to tail. These two diagrams over here show how this works at the molecular level. We're getting down and dirty and getting into the molecular mechanism for how this works. And if you look at the anterior end compared to the posterior end, what you see at the anterior end is some messenger RNAs from the gene bicoid. These messenger RNAs come from mom. The embryo doesn't produce them internally. They come from outside. They come from mom. Essentially, what mom is doing here at the anterior end by installing or triggering the generation of this high concentration of messenger RNA of bicoid is telling the embryo, this is your head, right? It doesn't decide. Mom decides that's the head. And by the way, this nanos gradient here, also from mom, is telling it, that's your tail. Now, it's true that, So there's external control right there, but it's also true.
I seem to have lost my share. I seem to have lost the connection. Oh dear. All right.
My tablet just lost connection, so I'm going to switch if I can to.
Hang on, let me just try again. Ah, I can do it. It's coming back, I hope. I don't know why that happened.
Okay. Oh, are we back? No, we're not back. Oh, dear. Try again. Share content. Screen. Start broadcast.
One more try, and then I'll just go to my laptop and broadcast from there, share from there.
No, it's losing it. Okay, let me go to my laptop. Thank you for bearing with me. Okay, can everybody see that? Great, okay. Well, I've got the problem with these little windows are in the way, but maybe I can work around. Okay, so in the bottom diagram, you see the bicoid gradient from mom and the nanos gradient from mom. And then you also see some endogenously generated gradients from hunchback and caudal. Those are entirely from the embryo. The embryo is making those mRNAs and those proteins. Mom initiated them. Bicoid triggered hunchback and nanos triggered caudal. But right now the embryo is doing it on its own. And you might be tempted to say, well, that doesn't look very internal, does it? It is, because at the scale, and I no longer have the capability of drawing on the screen because the tablet isn't there, but at the scale of the whole embryo, the whole that you're looking at on the left over in A, those genes are buried within individual cells. All they see is gradient. They don't know where the front is. They don't know where the back is. They don't know what segment they're going to become. They don't even know about segments. These are genes within single cells, and segments are many, many cells. All they see is hunchback. All they see is caudal, bicoid, nanos. That's what they see. That's all they can respond to. Luckily, that's enough. Luckily, the gradients themselves carry within them the information for the structure of the whole. Okay.
I forward slides.
Okay. So that's development. And the argument there is that genes are important. Genes provide critical information. They're providing all the substances here for these fields. All the substances are provided by the genes. But providing the substance is different from providing the large-scale structure. Genes just make hunchback, they make caudal, and then the large-scale structure has a different dynamic to it. Okay, so we have in this case, as in, I would argue, in all developmental systems, we have upper-level direction. Something larger than the thing being directed is doing the directing. We have some degree of lower-level freedom. Cells deviate all the time and come back. We have upper-level stability. These gradients are stable on long timescales relative to the individual cells within them. They meet all of my four architectural criteria. Okay, let me turn to the fourth kind of system, goal-directed system, adaptation and evolution. And I'm going to do this one relatively quickly, I think. The example I picked, just because I think turtles are cool, is the evolution of neck folding in turtles. Modern turtles, as you almost certainly know, can pull their heads under their shells. Ancient turtles, 200 million years ago, could not do this. They did not have foldable necks. Their necks were sticking out there waiting for a predator to bite them off. It's pretty clear that neck folding is an adaptation for avoidance of predation in modern turtles. Well, they got there by some route. From in the lower left of this diagram, you see the ancient ones. And then in the upper right, you see the modern neck folding ones. And this is a phenotype space. The thick arrow that I drew shows the peripatetic route that this lineage took from non-neck folding to folding. I'm making up, there is no data here, I'm making this up. But I know, given the nature of natural selection, that it must have been something like this because mutation is random. Population dynamics are population size dependent, and small populations are going to wander, they're going to drift in various ways. Nothing is going to stay right on target towards some adaptive peak. There's going to be wandering. But every time the lineage wanders away from a neck folding trajectory, there's natural selection. Or rather, in the terms I want to use, there's the higher level field. It's an ecology field, and it's present everywhere around the lineage. It's full of predators, it's full of nutrients, it's full of parasites, it's full of all the stuff that matters and produces selection pressures on this organism, right? It's way bigger than the organism. It's way bigger than the lineage. The lineage is immersed in it, right? There's the hierarchical structure to it. And the causality is downward. The ecology of which the turtle is a part, of which the lineage is a part, acts downwardly on the lineage, acts from above on the lineage, nudging it, giving it some oomph toward neck folding. Those other sets of arrows that you see along the way, five arrows above, five arrows below, are alternative courses the turtle lineage could have taken. There's nothing, this ecology field pushing it toward neck folding was not the only ecology field in operation. They could have taken a turn toward being fleet afoot and never evolved neck folding. That was a possibility. And so those possibilities are there all the time. Still, if you don't take those possibilities, if you stay within the neck folding field, there's this constant directionality, this constant push toward toward neck folding. The diagram over on the right, by the way, the schematic of the neck, A and B, of a turtle, it turns out, and this is kind of interesting in the current context, there are two groups of turtles around today, the cryptodires and the pleurodires. They both fold their necks, but they do it with radically different mechanisms. They evolved different mechanisms to do the same thing. In the cryptodires up top, you can see the in cross-sectional view, you can see the skull on the left and neck vertebrae 1 through 8. The hinges, where the fold take place between 5 and 6 in cryptodires and between 8 and the first dorsal vertebra. In pleurodires, down at the bottom, that I can't even see. I can't move that either. Hang on. Yeah, okay. The hinges are between 5 and 6 and between 2 and 3. And what's more, they're in a different plane. That's a down view in B. So what we're looking at is a higher level field, an ecology field that says to the lineage, to a couple lineages here, neck folding is advantageous, right? Here's a little oomph in the direction of neck folding. But biology being what it is, random variation being what it is, not all roots there are going to be the same. And two independent lineages took the same, not the same root, took different roots to the same functional result, to modern neck folding. Okay. That's all I'm going to say about adaptation. And as you can see in my little box down in the lower right at the end, we are now at the end of anything I know anything about. And we are now starting on the stuff I'm just making up. I really want to unify all 5 categories of goal-directedness under a single structural view. I want them all to have those 4 criteria. In the case of human, not just human, but all mammal, probably all animal, wanting, preferring, intending, and so on, here's where the externalist view leads you. It's sort of a hypothesis. It's a guess at what the structure of the brain sort of has to be like if it has the same architecture as all those other goal-directed systems. Why wouldn't it, right? All these other goal-directed systems have this architecture. Why wouldn't this one have? So speculating, thinking that it might, here's the kind of thing I would say about wanting, preferring, intending. I would start with a distinction between what today would be called affective processes and non-affective ones. And the non-affective ones are all the value-free processes, behaving, thinking, perceiving, calculating, imagining. I'm just going to call it all cognition. And you know what? My laptop does most of those. I don't know about the imagining, but it sure does calculating, perceiving. A lot of AI people want to give it credit for thinking. Sure, what the hell? Behaving, it does that. It does cognition. What it doesn't do, and what I and all other mammals and probably all animals do, is have motivation. It doesn't want, prefer, intend. It doesn't have emotions. It doesn't care. It doesn't have affect, right? So the proposal is going to be that all the non-affective processes, behaving, thinking, cognition, and so on, are the small goal-directed entities that are immersed within the upper-level affective fields, the wanting, preferring, intending fields that are physically large in the brain. I can't prove it, but nothing in neuroscience that I've read contradicts this. Physically large and encompassing of the smaller non-affective ones. So as you can see in my second entry in this argument under proposal, non-affective processes are the goal-directed entities. They're small, they're localized. Affect is the field. It's physically large and extended in a brain. It's physically encompassing of the non-affective systems. And the affective system directs the non-affective. Wants, preferences, intentions direct behaving and thinking. Now, I argued for an externalist view. All of this is internal to the brain, right? Yes, but internal, external is relative. Internal to the brain, but wants and intentions, I'm arguing, are external to behavior and cognition. So let's take an example and see how it works out in terms of the 5 criteria, 4 architectural features, and also in terms of persistence and plasticity. So here I am one evening sitting around, and it's just after dinner, and I'm not especially hungry, but I know there's a piece of cheesecake in the fridge, and I want it. I decide that I want it. So I intend to go get it. And I start to think about it for just a second. This doesn't take long. I'm going to get up. I'm going to walk to the fridge. I'm going to open it. I'm going to put it on a plate. I imagine all this looking forward, right? And then I actually do get up and start walking, and I trip over the edge of the carpet. We really got to weight that edge of the carpet down. What's the cat doing in my way? I sidestep the cat. And the phone rings, and I'm thinking of answering the phone, but you know, I know who it is, and I really want the cheesecake more. If you look at my thought process, if you look at my actual behavior, my physical movements, they're all over the place. What's persisting? The want is persisting. I keep coming back. There keeps coming back this nudge, fridge, cheesecake, right? Right? So there it is, the higher level field, the want, the intention. Driving, directing really is the word. Though in case of, in this case, I think driving is also a good word, but at least directing behavior and cognition, which are purely passive anyway. They respond, they do what they're told. Who's telling them? Affect is telling them. This, by the way, this whole ontology of the mind is stolen directly from David Hume and his theory of action. so all I'm doing is cashing it out in modern terms. This takes place on all time scales. That's from wanting to get a piece of cheesecake out of the fridge to intending to go to the post office. I've got a list of examples. Wanting to be a tennis star, that's out of the question now. Once upon a time, who knows, it might have been a possibility. You never know. It might have been a possibility. It's not anymore. Let's take something like wanting to buy a house, deciding to buy a house, intending to buy a house. I've been thinking of moving, buying a new house for about 10, 15 years now, thinking seriously about it. I've done nothing, almost nothing about it. My wife has checked out real estate listings from time to time. We haven't actually gotten off our butts to go visit a house or gone to a bank to check out the mortgage rates and all that stuff. We've checked online, but nothing serious. There it sits in the back of our brain, something we might do, an urge for the new house, right? And if you just look at me, my behavior, you won't seem like, if you look at my intentions, mostly my cognition, it has to do with other things. I'm mostly not thinking about houses. This comes up, you know, every couple months. But there's the field, weak, present, nudging me every so often, getting its way and getting me to think about, and one day probably getting me to actually behave in ways that will lead me to buying a new house. So again, all time scales, same architecture. And I would argue exactly the same four criteria. There you see them down at the bottom. We clearly have persistence and plasticity. We have hierarchy. I'm arguing we have hierarchy. Behavior lies physically inside. Cognition and behavior lies inside wants, preferences, intentions. We've got upper direction. We've got partial lower level freedom. There's deviation all over the place, but there are the wants. And upper level stability, my wants change slowly. I'm going to spend just the last 60 seconds or so talking about this fifth one, which is not an architectural criterion, but I think is a property, and it's an interesting one in this context, vagueness. It's interesting that from the perspective of lower level entities, upper level fields are always going to be somewhat vague. Look at this, look at the bacterium. Look at the perspective of the food gradient from the bacterium's point of view. Here I am in this aspartate field. I move a little bit. Whoa, here I am in the aspartate field. I move a little bit. Oh, here I am. It's more concentrated, right? It's sort of mysterious, this aspartate field. Where is it exactly? It's everywhere, right? Which is just the way that your car treats the GPS field, the cell phone tower field around. It's everywhere. That's how it manages to be goal-directed, because wherever it wanders, there's the field. But looking up at it, it's very hard to identify what it is. It's vague, right? I'm suggesting that one of the reasons that affect is so hard for us to put our finger on, to describe in words, describe what it means to want to buy a house. So I can talk about houses, I can talk about buying. What does the want look like? I know what it feels like, but what is it? What is it? Describe it. Put your hands in your pockets and describe it. It's hard to do, maybe impossible to do. As you'd expect, if wants were a higher level field and my only perspective was looking up at them, I want to go to the post office. Stuff happens, I'm driving around. There it is again, I want to go to the post office. More stuff happens, I end up distracted and chatting with somebody else. There it is again. Where is the wanting to go to the post office? It's very hard to say. It's like looking at a cloud from the inside when you're flying through it, a big cloud. Where is it? It's everywhere, but nowhere in particular. That's one of the signatures of hierarchical systems. There's a bunch of rate signatures too, which all of these systems seem to have. but that's my pitch for wanting, preferring, intending in an externalist view. Let me just close with this concluding remark, which I think will make sense. We'll see if it does. The puzzle of goal-directedness is a puzzle in time, the seeming backward causation, the future causing the present. But I'm proposing that the solution is actually in space. It isn't in time. It's because upper-level fields manage to be everywhere that it looks like causality operating in reverse time. And I'll end there.